I'm always happy to come here and be with all of you. Tonight is a special, very special honor for me as we celebrate a remarkable couple who rise to the moment every day to champion our shared values. The Tzedek V'Shalom Award, Justice and Peace, is one that will be awarded to Stephen Robert and Pilar Crespi Robert. For decades, Stephen and Pilar's Source of Hope Foundation has provided critical resources, health care, and educational opportunity for communities ravaged by violence, natural disaster, and inequality. In the Middle East, Stephen and Pilar's work honors the dignity and worth of every person, and their commitment to justice and peace is essential to Israelis and Palestinians coming together to see a different future. They're not ones to stand on the sidelines. Instead of focusing on people-to-people connections that promote mutual respect and plant the seeds for lasting peace. Now, let me just say, they're not ones to stand on the sidelines, but they're never ones to put themselves in the spotlight. So when I heard and learned that they were willing to publicly accept this award for work that they have been doing silently for so long, I knew how important this was to them, because they have quietly always been helpful to so many people without those beneficiaries even knowing. They're so lovely, so kind, so not promoting. They have met the urgency of the moment with fierce determination, empowering local leaders and citizens to use their voices to build a more just, peaceful, and prosperous future for all. Stephen and Pilar's bold vision and values-based leadership are an inspiration to us all. You're going to learn more about them in a film that we're going to see momentarily. But for the moment, on behalf of the Congress of the United States, and in honor of their commitment to justice and peace, is a privilege to present to Tzedek V'Shalom, Tzedek V'Shalom, Tzedek V'Shalom, Peace and Liberty and Peace Award to Stephen and Pilar Robert.
Street's argument is that it's important to be both pro-Israel and pro-peace, that the two go together. That is something that Stephen and Pilar believe in their bones. That is something that they understand is critical, that political activism designed to promote a lasting reconciliation between these two communities is essential.
I think they really understand that they can contribute to making a difference in the world, and they do. And they get up in the morning and they really look at what's happening in the world.
I think what's at the core of Pilar and Stephen's philanthropic value set is that they care about human beings. You know, Henry Street Settlement was founded on observing challenges that society faced and observing challenges that people face and then responding. And I think Pilar and Stephen are made up of similar chemistry. When they see people that are vulnerable, when they see people who need support, when they see something that's unjust, they take action.
It is very clear to me that Pilar and Stephen share the same vision that we have in the parent circle. That is, that there has to be a framework for a reconciliation process as an integral part of any future political peace agreement. They've shown it in their support for us. They've shown it in the visits that they made here. Pilar especially showed it when she met the women, the bereaved mothers, Palestinian and Israeli, in the group, and how much empathy she showed for their stories.
I think that his philanthropic activity led him naturally to this focus on trying to find ways at the grassroots level to try to create an environment that can help advance reconciliation between Israelis and Palestinians, between these two communities.
JCDU is an organization with big ideas, but our impact is still not big enough. Activists such as Pilar and Stephen provide leadership, inspiration for us to move forward, to make our vision a reality. They are the people that inspire me and my generation to do the hard work needed to make a better future possible in Israel and Palestine.
Stephen and Pilar want to inspire change by virtue of the generosity that they have. Not just handing people something, but making sure that their generosity helps to foster a sense of well-being, a sense of community, a sense of improvement, a sense of hope.
They spend a lot of time here on the Lower East Side with us. They spend time meeting the people that we serve.
The American administration has decided not to fund any cross-border activities. We need more than ever people like Steve and Pilar who understand that you cannot bring the Palestinians to their knees and then expect that they will make peace.
The whole prospect of Israeli-Palestinian reconciliation is now at risk in a way it's never been before, that drives Stephen and Pilar's support for J Street and drives J Street's efforts to preserve Israel as a Jewish and democratic state at peace with the Palestinians.
Congratulations, Stephen and Pilar. You deserve this award. Your work is inspiring to people like me and my generation.
Congratulations, Stephen and Pilar, for receiving this prestigious award.
Congratulations, Pilar and Stephen. I could not think of a more fitting award for more deserving people.
Congratulations, my friends. I can't think of two people who more deserve this award.
Heartfelt congratulations, Stephen and Pilar, on this very well-earned Justice and Peace Tzedek V'Shalom Award from J Street.
Good evening, and thank you for being here. Thank you. Thank you, Nancy and Chuck, for your lovely introduction. And thank you, Jeremy, for honoring us this evening in our work for the Source of Hope Foundation. I also wanted to thank our family and friends who are here tonight. Just over a decade ago, Steve and I started Source of Hope. We wanted to work with the very poor, the unprotected, the people that sometimes are invisible, that are at the very basis of our society. Inequality, hardship, and oppression are all issues that are very important to us and to the core of our work. During our travels to refugee camps in Greece and Jordan, we have seen unimaginable despair. The refugees told us of horrific hardship they went through, sometimes because of the war, other times because of a lack of health care, or just because the society had failed them. Steve and I are often discouraged by the many obstacles and setbacks in our work. But we also know that if we can improve and bring hope to the life of just one individual, it has all been worth it. Source of Hope has programs in Haiti, Jordan, Colombia, Ethiopia, the United States. But our work in Israel and Palestine is one that both Steve and I have embarked with passion and dedication. We believe that a two-state solution is the only path to peace. And this is the reason we support J Street, Hand in Hand, the Parent Circle, Just Vision, B'Tselem, Polyphony, Ir Amin, and a few other organizations that share
that share a vision and are working towards the principle of inclusion and respect among the Israelis and Palestinians. But above all, it has been Steve's dedication and commitment to this cause that have been for me a constant source of inspiration. And now, Steve.
I like applause, so I'm not going to fake it. I enjoy it. I'm not nervous about speaking to 1,300 people. I don't know why, but I'm not. I am a little nervous about speaking after Pilar. That's heavy duty. Thank you, Pilar. You have been the heart and soul of Source of Hope, and its mandate to help the millions of invisible but vulnerable people in the world. Pilar, you are my source of hope every single day. Chuck, I've been your admirer and friend for several decades, as you mentioned. Even during my delusional period of trying to be a moderate Republican, you created a Democratic majority in the Senate once, and we will help you succeed a second time. At times we've disagreed, but your willingness to listen is unparalleled. You are a great public servant. It would be impossible to describe all the good things you've done for the state of New York. And Pilar and I are so grateful that you've joined us tonight. Nancy, you are our dear friend. Your principles, courage, empathy, and equanimity are an inspiration to us all. Your eloquent and powerful defense of our republic restores our hope. At a time when our most basic values are under constant attack, you remind us of who we really are. Thank you for restoring our pride in being Americans. Pilar and I so appreciate this honor. Thank you, Jeremy Ben-Ami, for this recognition and for your unfailing dedication to a just peace. It is quite remarkable that in roughly 10 years, you have, with the wind more in your face than in your back perhaps, created this marvelous, vibrant, effective organization for which the world, when the history is written, will forever be grateful. We also want to thank the entire J Street team, not only for this weekend, but for your incredible dedication every day of the year. Okay. We are meeting in Washington tonight and dark times for both the countries we love. For Israel, the toxic alliance of Trump and Netanyahu has brought the nation to a precipice of disaster. Democracy in both the United States and Israel is being diminished by leadership's constant attack on the separation of powers and their denial of the equality of every human being. Both governments have weaponized hatred and weakened protections for the most vulnerable. Dead set against a two-state solution, they seek to relegate this idea to the dustbin of history. We will not allow that to happen. The words of former Secretary of State John Kerry ring true. He said, "The two-state solution is the only way to achieve a just and lasting peace between Israelis and Palestinians. It is the only way to ensure Israel's future as a Jewish and democratic state living in peace and security with its neighbors." J Street has gathered thousands of us this weekend who fight steadfastly for a secure two-state solution. Why do we fight on? Some of our fellow Jews refer to us as present-day capos. Trump calls us disloyal, although he doesn't rail against his anti-Semitic followers. We risk our reputations in our communities. Having written 10 published articles on this subject, I've been called anti-Semitic and a self-hating Jew. I'm not sure how you can be both those things, but I've been called I've been called them both. I've alienated some of my oldest and best friends. Perhaps we need to make peace with ourselves before making peace with the Palestinians. In fact, we all love and are deeply loyal to Israel. There's not one person in this room who isn't deeply loyal to Israel. We believe, however, that the ultimate loyalty is the ability to criticize out of love. And if criticizing out of love makes us anti-Semitic or whatever, we should be happy to have that label. Imbued with a sense of history, we are all beneficiaries of the Enlightenment, the era in which our own Constitution was written. Leaders without respect for those values pose an extreme danger. Government by the consent of the governed is a principle we will never abandon. The 1948 Israeli Declaration of Independence followed ours by almost 200 years. Yet the core values are nearly identical. The American Declaration helped reset the relationship between governments and the governed for much of the world. We all remember, "We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men, and now women, are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain inalienable rights, and among these rights are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness." And then the Israeli Declaration in 1948. "The State of Israel will be open for Jewish immigration and for the ingathering of exiles. It will be based on freedom, justice, and peace, as envisioned by the prophets of Israel. It will ensure complete equality of social and political rights to all its inhabitants, irrespective of religion, race, or sex. It will guarantee freedom of religion, conscience, language, education, and culture. It will safeguard the holy places of all religions, and it will be faithful to the principles of the Charter of the United Nations. Well, at that point in 1948, we had it right. More recently, however, there's been a significant erosion, very significant erosion of democracy in Israel. President Reuven Rivlin warns that those in power are working to delegitimize the gatekeepers of Israelis' democracy. No doubt he was referring to the right's continuous attacks on the Supreme Court and Israel's justice system. Israeli NGOs funded by foreign entities are being harassed. Support for annexation is rising. Former Shin Bet chief Yuval Diskin has stated, "We have good reason to be terrified by the ethical and moral rot that leads us. Damaging the separation of powers in the country and trying to infiltrate the process by which elected officials are investigated." Now, I guess I would say, if you remember anything that I say tonight, I hope you'll remember this next part because it's very important and surprisingly not very widely known. Perhaps this concern anticipated the Israeli nation-state bill, which passed the Knesset in 2018. By the way, the most far-right government in Israel's history worked for 7 years to get this bill passed. The law's supporters argue it merely codifies what already existed. Its opponents see it as undemocratic and racist, allowing one religious group to deny equal rights to another. It would make a mockery of the Declaration of Independence. A law like this paves the road to apartheid. To me, the law is a wolf in sheep's clothing. It's really kind of funny when you read it, because it starts off saying things that are so uncontroversial. It says, the name of the state will be Israel. Okay. The flag will be the flag as we've always known it. The national anthem will be HaTikvah, and the national symbol will be the menorah. And so you read all this and you say, well, this is virtually a given anyway. What's everyone excited about? And then you come to the paragraph that says, the exercise of the right to national self-determination in the state of Israel is unique to the Jewish people. And the state views the development of Jewish settlement as a national value and shall act to encourage and promote its establishment and strengthening. Ladies and gentlemen, the right to self-determination is a cardinal principle in modern international law since the time of President Wilson. It is intolerable to deny 20% of Israel's population a proportionate say in this right. Moreover, the law could be seen to legitimize any efforts to promote the relocation of Israeli Palestinians from Israel that some, like Avigdor Lieberman, have in the past proposed. If you question still what the framers of this law had in mind, listen to the words of Ayelet Shaked, the justice minister who guided the passage of the bill in describing the bill's importance. This is, you almost wonder whether she could have said this, but she did. She said, Judaizing Galilee is legitimate without violating the full rights of the Palestinian citizens of Israel. There is a place to maintain a Jewish majority even at the price of a violation of rights. Maintaining a Jewish majority in Israel and acting democratically must be parallel, and one must not outweigh the other. Israel is a Jewish state. It isn't a state of all its nations. That is, equal rights to all its citizens, but not equal national rights. Our intention is to keep the word equality out of the nation-state bill. Minister Shaked may not have the final word here, but her words certainly provide a guide to the bill's dangers and intent. My friends, we all have many objectives for the country we love, what we hope to be the democratic Jewish state. But if our hopes have any chance of success, this law cannot stand. Can this tragic situation change? David Ben-Gurion, Israel's first prime minister, said that Israel will be judged by how it treats the Arabs. Believing that, we are determined to alter the current trajectory. Over 100 years of bloodshed and tears have caused both sides to eviscerate all empathy for their neighbors. The majority of Israeli Jews reject the Palestinian narrative just as the Palestinians reject theirs. Since empathy is the oxygen of morality, without empathy, immorality becomes rampant. Israel, no longer the vulnerable victim, is by far the strongest military power in the Middle East. Israel has won the war, though its security can never be taken for granted. Still, the victor in a war always has the burden of creating a fair and sustainable peace. Israel then carries the heavier responsibility for a just and sustainable solution. Sadly, many Jews view the Palestinians as an inferior people, thus justifying their horrendous treatment. Hide them behind a wall, pretend they don't exist. From time to time, the IDF will remind them of their non-status. Some term that, including Israeli ministers, managing the situation or mowing the grass. That is the language of thugs. For we Jews, it cannot be tolerated. Detached from the teachings of history, this policy of denying 4 to 5 million Palestinians their inalienable rights will have an apocalyptic end. Do not let the passage of time anesthetize us to the inevitable disaster. We must overcome years of hatred. Neither side can erase their numerous past mistakes. A better future, however, is still possible. Israel has made itself strong. Now it must rediscover its altruism and reach out generously to its Palestinian neighbors. No government will succeed in making peace without leading its people in this direction. Jews on the issues of morality should be a beacon unto the world. We must not lose our moral compass. Almost all Israeli Jews are barred from visiting the Palestinian cities and towns in the West Bank or entering Gaza. Ignorance blinds them to the injustice in which they are complicit. Israel needs a strong democratic government which will lead it from this abyss. Pilar and I have been visiting the West Bank for many years. The situation there is unconscionable. Imprisoned behind concrete walls, the Palestinians lack water, health care, freedom of movement, civil rights, and a national identity. Can we not cry for the Palestinian child who dies waiting behind an interminable checkpoint line to receive medical care? Do not this child's parents feel the same insufferable grief as would you or me? Can we abide depriving families of water when illegal Jewish settlements above have swimming pools? It infuriated us. We met a father in the Hebron market whose 13-year-old son had been blinded the day before by a Molotov cocktail thrown by Jewish settlers living above the market. Our hearts broke. Graduates of our own Source of Hope engineering program were blocked from traveling to vital internships abroad. Try explaining this to an intelligent, ambitious kid. President Rivlin, discussing the horrific treatment of the Palestinians, said, "I'm not worried if we forgot how to be Jews. I'm worried if we forgot how to be decent human beings." Like many of us who are here tonight, I grew up with a strong connection and love for Israel. My father fled from the Ukraine at 13 years old to escape the deadly pogroms. He headed our local synagogue in the United Jewish Appeal. My mother was president of Hadassah and an early supporter of Brandeis, where an art gallery dedicated to her is still thriving. My parents loved Israel and knew from bitter experience its existential importance. I've visited Israel many times since my first trip in 1962. A sliver of land inhabited by our people. I was awed by its accomplishments and by its vulnerability. In 1967, I swelled with pride at the military prowess of my fellow Jews and the eloquence of Foreign Minister Abba Ibn defending Israel at the United Nations. As an investment banker, I helped finance multiple Israeli businesses, particularly in technology. I was a fundraiser for UJA Federation, a governor of the American Jewish Committee, and a founding director of the Museum of Jewish Heritage, a living memorial to the Holocaust. Pilar and I have supported J Street practically since its inception, and as Pilar said, multiple philanthropies in Israel dedicated to humanitarian causes and peace. Now, however, Israel's government is leading it into an abyss. Speaker Pelosi, in a recent speech about impeachment, quoted Thomas Paine, "The times have found us," he said. For those of us who care deeply about Israel's future as a democratic Jewish state, the times have well and truly found us. J Street is invaluable in this battle. It is an American movement fighting for a better future for Israelis and Palestinians, a movement with smart, compassionate people, cutting through obfuscation, distraction, and untruths. It needs and deserves our utmost support. All of us must rise to meet this moment. Thomas Paine also had some words on resilience. He said, "I love the man that can smile in trouble, that can gather strength from distress and grow brave by reflection. 'Tis the business of little minds to shrink, but he whose heart is firm and whose conscience approves his conduct will pursue his principles until death." Thank you all for joining the fight.